Hey guys, what's up? I'm Adam from GeekRest.com, joined with
Aaron from a comic show, a comic shop.
Mm-hmm. You have more titles than I do, more locations.
In a comic shop.
In a comic shop.
Adam, the bartender of the Geek Easy, that's a title.
What can I get you? This is the 7th day comic book news recap video. You know, once a week we're doing these videos, just recapping some of the highlights, not everything, although this week it feels like we covered everything, because nothing from Marvel.
Yeah, there wasn't all that much news, but the news that was big.
Big.
Yes.
I mean, like, waves of big. Well, the first single thing we should talk about is this whole Damian Wayne thing.
Right.
This was, DC has announced Damian Wayne's coming back.
Back
in
to
a
the
form,
future.
In a form, back to the future. He's coming back in a 4-issue miniseries called, Damian, Son of the Batman?
Something like that, maybe.
Something like that. But this is going to be by, you know, Andy Kubert, who written and illustrated. And, you know, we saw him do this. He knows Damian.
Yeah, he did 666 Batman, you know, with that issue, and he's done other stuff with Grant Morrison. So, you know, it remains to be seen, like, how much of a writer, but it'll be visually stunning.
Yes.
And who knows what this is, if it's an alternate future, the real future, the new 52 future.
I know.
The old 52 future. I don't know, but I'm interested.
The single image they showed, I believe it was the cover, but it's a teenage Damian.
Right.
And, I mean, I know it was on Bleeding Cool. They're just like, oh, wait, that's like the pre-New 52 costume he's got. And even Batman in the background, he's wearing his pre-New 52. DC swears that the pre-Flashpoint universe does not exist anymore. So that we're not going to see that. I mean, that'd be cool.
But its future might be an alternate future. I don't know.
We don't know. I mean, these are cool ideas, though. I would love to think that there's a pre-Flashpoint universe out there.
Why not? You know,
it's
like
smart as hell if they did that.
Right.
Because we know that world.
Yes.
We know it well. And a lot of us are sad it's gone.
And some of those characters are completely gone, and they could be in like an Exiles Sliders-esque team, even
Sliders.
With Wally and Donna and Stephanie Brown and whoever. You know, there's plenty of characters that aren't around. Like even like Connor Hawk, Green Arrow. Just throw these characters together, put them in a Sliders type, Exiles type team, and let them do their work. And maybe they can't wear those costumes in the New 52 universe when they jump in there because it would affect time and space and whatever, but in and out, fast, and make the leader of the team Booster.
Booster,
Of course.
He brought Jonah Hex into the future.
Yes.
You can move everyone around like chess pawns.
But that's just us, you know,
that's
just speculating.
Everyone's going to be talking about this. It comes out October 30th, like I said, 4-issue mini, but exciting though. Damian fans, you got something to look forward to. DC Comics also announced that they are going to be relaunching, revamping, re-energizing their Vertigo line.
Right, with this whole marketing defy campaign.
Right.
Like, defy your expectations, defy the competition, defy these genres, defy everything. And they're trying to reclaim that ground that they made, that they paved,
I know.
That road. And, you know, like, they're putting their money where their mouth is, at least.
They need to. I mean, Vertigo was awesome. It was defining. It was the place for new artists and creators to come in and kind of get ushered into. I mean, it's their spiritual line. It's like they're more offbeat crime.
It became part of DC's DNA, though, when these writers went from Vertigo wacky stuff, creator-owned stuff, into their main titles. Even with the New 52, two of the best writers of New 52, Jeff Lemire, Scott Snyder, were part of this new generation of Vertigo on Sweet Tooth and American Vampire. It's undeniable, you know, that this is where they can pull their next great writers from by letting them have creative freedom over here.
And Vertigo's been kind of like bleeding out, I mean, for the past several years, but like you said, Snyder with American Vampire, that's like one of their staples now. The Wake that he just put out with
the best launch of Vertigo number one in Dan DiDio's entire tenure.
Right.
Like,
I
heard this from Dan DiDio's mouth at the Retail Roadshow.
Hey, that's, you know,
so
your own grave. So I mean that's awesome. I mean, but there have been some books like, you know, Saucer Country I loved, but didn't hold, you know, it didn't hold anything.
And they didn't hold Paul Cornell at all in the New 52 either. He went to Marvel.
Yeah, that's your loss.
So, you know, we don't know in the background of that. We don't know the background of Andy Diggle, but we do know that, you know, where they're going and that necessarily seems like Image.
And their biggest book coming
out? And we'll
out?
Get into Image.
Oh, we're getting there, yeah, because they're kind of, you know, it's a little intertwined, I think.
Yes.
Sandman, Overture.
Overture.
This is going to be a prequel. It is going to be a miniseries. It's going to be bi-monthly. It's going to be Neil Gaiman again.
With J.H. Williams III on art.
Yeah.
Like, beautiful art. He's always
beautiful
worked with
art.
Multiple artists, but always great artists that have, like, a certain just style, a certain uniqueness, you know,
yeah,
that really fits whatever story he's telling in Sandman, because Sandman is such this elastic character that you could tell a bunch of stories through him and around him. Sometimes he's a protagonist, sometimes he's, you
right
know, this aloof observer, but, you know, this seems awesome. This, well, you know, like,
this is exciting. I mean, Neil Gaiman was one of the biggest strengths of Vertigo, even though when he first launched Sandman, that wasn't Vertigo. They brought it into Vertigo, I remember.
Alan Moore's Swamp Thing was, like, basically the first Vertigo book, even though it wasn't Vertigo. And then from there, it was, you know,
right,
Doom Patrol, Animal Man, Sandman, all these books became
yep
what Vertigo launched as. And it's nice to have, like, their big flagship thing back,
yeah,
even though, you know, Swamp Thing's in the DC Universe. I think he works well in that as well. You know,
yeah,
Charles Soule's kicking ass in that. But Sandman's the type of character, and obviously Neil is the type of creator that doesn't want to be bound to 51 other books.
Right,
you know?
Right.
So this is great, and this is a nice tent, like, obviously the tent pole for this Defy launch.
Definitely.
Of, you know, you can run through the titles if you want.
I was about to say, but what's equally as brilliant about bringing something back that everyone knows and you know, the strong, you know, character, creative talent, is the fact that they also announced these six new titles that have such a wide array of creative teams.
Right.
Like, I mean, some of these people, many people will not have heard of.
Comic,
you know,
people probably haven't heard of, but
yeah,
some of them are novelists. That,
yeah,
you know, DC is, or Vertigo is mining that.
And they released, you know, some of the cover art for some of these books, and they just look wild and fun and new and fresh, and it's exciting to see all this stuff coming out of an imprint that really hasn't been pushing a lot.
And dissimilar from each other, other than, like, Dead Boy Detectives was a spinoff of Sandman.
Right.
And that Hinterkind sounds in the same wheelhouse maybe as Fables and,
yeah,
and Sandman, but all this other stuff is just new crazy stuff. I mean, Witching Hour is an anthology, and they did
Witching
a book
Hour is an anthology,
called
yeah
Witching Hour back in the day by
yeah
Jeff Loeb, actually.
Really?
Yeah. So,
wow.
You know, but that's an anthology, but other things like Suiciders and Coffin Hill and all this just wacky
Coffin
stuff.
Coffin Hill looks awesome.
The Discipline, just crazy stuff. Let's experiment. Like, that was Vertigo's
right
thing, and it hit me so well in high school when, you know, I was obviously experimenting with sex and drugs.
Yes.
And I wanted a little experimentation with my comic books. I didn't want the same old spandex. So
yeah,
you know, maybe
yeah
it'll get
not
a new generation.
This is not for superheroes. And finally, Image Comics. This may be why DC pushed the Vertigo stuff last week so much, because the Image
yes
Comics Expo.
Yes.
Second annual. We talked about this last year. They announced a wave of new titles that
were all
everyone talked about.
Successful.
Grown and
all,
one of the,
everything
I mean,
was awesome. Yeah.
Got new stuff from Mark Millar. You got Fraction. Two books from Remender.
Right.
And Jason Aaron's first creator-owned work since the Marvel contract. His Marvel contract.
Yeah. Since
wrapped up.
You know. And before that, it was just Scalped, which was just kind of like grandfathered in
yeah
to, like, he's been, this is his first
Vertigo.
it's only his second long-form creator-owned thing he's ever done.
Right.
And you look at his body of work, and it's like, oh, wow, you know,
yeah,
this is cool. And it's called Southern Bastards.
Southern,
like,
Bastards.
Like, this dude doesn't even have to do much research for this. And I was busting his balls when he was signing here at the store
right
a few weeks ago, and he told me about this. I was like, you don't even have to do any research for that. You know, you're like the Alabama corn snake. You know, you worked at, like, a porno store in Alabama.
Yeah.
Like, you could write this in your sleep, you
this
know?
Is...
And Jason Latour, who's in Atlanta, is drawing it and will be co-writing.
Yep.
I don't know if that was probably announced. I mean, they did interviews, but,
yeah,
you know, I know this because I talked to him. And they might have other artists come on for different, you know,
yeah,
like, little runs and story arcs. But, wow, this is cool. It's like, you know, Sons of Anarchy, like, just comic book.
That's
just
what I'm
Jason
thinking
Aaron kind of, you know, like, it's like, it's even a play on words, like Southern Baptist, Southern Bastards, you
yeah
know? I want to just, like, baptize myself in beer and then read it, you know?
Read this book. If you're not stinking of beer when you're reading this
yeah
book,
you're
doing
not doing
it wrong.
It right. Moving on.
That's just it's awesome. I mean, you know, so many new titles coming out, like I said, you know, Millar, him, and
this is a good thing that Marvel didn't renew all these these exclusive contracts with their writers when Marvel and DC had this whole like cold war between like locking up writers.
Yeah.
And who lost was, you know, they couldn't do creator own work unless it was by Icon or, you know, grandfathered in weirdness. Mm-hmm. And then with Image doing all this crazy successful stuff, I wonder if these writers didn't really even push for exclusive contracts to be renewed because they were chomping at the bit to do some of this stuff through through Image or, you know, whatnot. Like Remender.
I got
to
imagine having a creator-owned title in between your exclusive contracts is like, you know, helps you breathe a little bit. You know, it gives you room for growth and gives the, you know, publishers like the big two, I don't know, just something better to, you know, bring back into the fold. These people need to do creator-owned titles. Is what I'm saying. You're with Marvel and DC for only so long doing the same stuff. Eventually, you start phoning it in, and you know.
Well, you know your voice. You know what, like Remender when he does his own stuff, he has this pulpy, quirky, irreverent, you know, punk rock voice.
Right.
And, you know, like Fear Agent and all this stuff that he's done, you know, and it bleeds into Uncanny X-Force, and it bleeds into Uncanny Avengers here or there where, you know, Havoc says something completely ridiculous, and then he's like, oh, you could drown in hobo piss. It's like, that's a Rick Remender I know.
Yep.
You guys. And, you know, Deadly Class and Black Science, we're going to get this, right?
Yeah.
I mean, that's cool.
Very
I want
exciting.
It.
Another big announcement that came out of there. Well, not, you know, I mean, super huge, but it's a little bit of a game changer. DRM-free digital comics. Image Comics announced that their storefront is totally going to be DRM-free. Now, that's digital rights management, for people who don't know. And it's what Comicology has on all their digital comics that you buy through their store. It basically means, I mean, when you buy a comic book through Comicology, you don't actually download a digital copy of it. You basically have access to the book. You know, it's still owned by the company per se, but now you have bought the rights to, you know, license it to your own device. One of the big things that, but I mean now with DRM free, you can download any file format you want. You can choose your own file format. You can keep this digital copy for yourself.
And you could share it if you want.
You could share it if you want.
Didn't Comixology crash? Their servers crashed when Marvel offered all those free downloads and people couldn't access their database of stuff they paid for while it was crashed.
Yeah.
That sucks. You paid for it.
That's
you know?
A huge problem for that. I was just going to that example. You just
I thought you were
going
to. I was trying to keep you on track.
No,
I didn't mean to steal your thunder.
I was
going to
say that's one of the biggest problems is that, you know.
And what if Comixology went bankrupt one day?
What if it crashes?
Crashes and burns.
If it's gone, your books are gone.
Right.
So this is an alternative. And it's also, Image realizes that piracy is just a couple degrees away from just saying people are sharing it and people are previewing their books. It's not necessarily hurting their sales. If people like these books, these single issue books, it's like The Walking Dead or something like that. A lot of people I know actually read the digital copies of these books first.
Right.
They are now buying these hardcover books. They're buying the trade paperbacks. They want these collections. They may not be buying the single issues, but the money does come back to the publisher.
And
Image Comics knows
them,
this.
Some of them have to be slowly buying the digital stuff instead of just pirating because it's just so much easier and just the ease of use because they showed the growth they had in both digital sales and in the book market.
Yep.
And the growth in digital sales and the book market both show that these people that are sampling it with piracy might move to buying it digitally are going to the book market, not necessarily coming into a store like mine, unless, you know, I have a signing or something really cool to get them in, which I should be doing.
Or
but,
sale, you know, in the trades.
So, you know, I think they have the metrics to make their case, and they're willing to give it a shot.
And
that's
willing
their
to
right.
gamble.
Yeah.
And that's absolutely, that's awesome. A lot of people were excited. Basically, out of the Image Expo, no one had a problem with everything they announced.
They're being more innovative with content and with format.
Right.
I mean, that's cool.
Yeah.
And for the number three publisher to be like that, that's pretty awesome. That's very healthy for the overall industry.
Yep.
So
we'll see how that trickles into the actual, you know, market and everything. But, I mean, taking chances, that's what Image is great for.
Yes.
Across the board. Well, that's it, pretty much. Weekly highlight recap. Thanks for tuning in. Tune in to Aaron on a comic show. I'll see you on geekrest.com, and I'll see you next week.
Bye.